Redefining diversity, competence, integrity, and work ethic through one location, one phone call. Introducing Signature Hill.
Hello, my name is Attorney Angelo Papa. To my left is Dr. John Wrightson. And to my right is Dr. Peter Iacino. He is the educational division. I am the person in the legal division, and this is our medical division. We have a simple message for children. We decided to start it with, under Dr. Peter Iacino's guidance, in the schoolhouse. He calls it another voice. You see, I think the children get it. I've spent enough time as a former administrator, coach, teacher, to know that if you sit a child down, they get it. They know that they shouldn't drive a car under the influence. But I'm not so sure they know how easy it is to drive a car under the influence without thinking about it. So many times we as educators, lawyers, doctors, we tend to get frustrated that they're not listening. So this is an attempt, our attempt, to keep on working every single day to as creatively as possible find ways to have them listen. We have found that people are interested in the legal system. We also find a lot of people have criminal problems with substance problems. So we thought it would be no better place than to start in the anvil of litigation, in the pushback of a prosecutor doing their duty and a defense attorney doing theirs, so that we could arrive at more well-reasoned decisions. By joining the educators, we now reach the children proactively that have not yet experimented, and reactively provide quality help for those that we may have missed. The most important thing is for you to watch this video. We've taken some liberties with it. Attorney Alexander Lindsay was our playwright, and he rewrote this real-life movie so that this trial could be possible. You need to know that the driver in the real-life video died. In our real-life video, in our adaptation of that, our driver survives. And our driver survives only to find himself, by the duty of a diligent prosecutor, now in jeopardy for homicide by vehicle and a cascade of civil possible outcomes and bad outcomes. You also need to know that the parents where these children were drinking is a subject of interest to our district attorney, serious interest, and could be facing serious charges also. So this is our humble way from the medical division and our educational division and myself and these wonderful people who have come here to help us today to find a way to creatively get the children to listen to this important message. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, thank you for being here. So for the prosecution and the defense, we introduce to you your defendant, your client, and good luck to both of you.
All rise. Everybody please be seated except the jurors. Will the jurors please raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear or affirm that to reach a verdict you promise to follow all the rules explained by the judge, promise to decide the facts of the case only upon the evidence presented in the courtroom, promise to apply the law as the judge explains it to you, and promise to be fair to all parties in this case? If so, answer I do.
I do.
Good morning, members of the jury. Ladies and gentlemen, jury service comes with great responsibility, but it can be the experience of a lifetime, and it is the pinnacle of public service for each American citizen. You're being called upon to decide whether or not the government has proven a fellow citizen guilty of one or more criminal offenses. The way that you do your job is as important as the way that the court does its job and the attorneys do their jobs. Pay close attention to everything that is said and done in this courtroom so that you can perform your duties well. This case is a tragic story, ladies and gentlemen, about a graduation night from high school for a group of teenagers. It's not about our graduation night or the graduation night of our children or our grandchildren. So whatever memories you have from your graduation night, whether good or bad, that happened to you or perhaps one of your family members or friends, you must disregard those memories. They have no part in this case. This is not an opportunity to send a message at all to the community about how we should behave on graduation night. This is about whether or not the government has proven to you beyond a reasonable doubt each and every element of the charges that have been filed against Jake Matthews. Jake Matthews is the defendant in this case, ladies and gentlemen, and he's been accused by the government of three separate crimes. And it is the government's duty to prove to you that he committed the crime of driving under the influence of alcohol. They have two ways to prove that. One is to prove that he was under the influence of alcohol to the degree that he was not capable of safe driving. The second way they have to prove that is to prove that he was operating a motor vehicle and that within 2 hours after driving that vehicle, his blood alcohol content was 0.02 or greater if they proved to you that he was under the age of 21. The second offense they have charged against him is the charge of homicide by vehicle. The third charge is homicide by DUI. As you know, the government has the burden of proof. It is their obligation to go first. Ms. Lauterbaugh, do you have any witnesses for the Commonwealth at this point?
I do, Your Honor. Corporal Debbie Ogden.
Please come forward, ma'am. Let's pull this microphone down. There you go.
Thank you, Corporal. Corporal, will you please tell the jury what happened in this case?
Yes. On June 7th, 2005, this officer received a call from dispatch at 124 to report to the intersection of 8th and Burnside, which was the scene of an automobile collision. I arrived at 8th and Burnside, the crash scene, at 1:38. This officer observed a late, dark-colored Ford Explorer. The automobile was on its roof. There appeared to be extensive damage to the Explorer. EMTs and firemen had recently arrived at the scene and were in the process of extricating the occupants of the Ford SUV, the vehicle number one. Also in the intersection was a light-colored Lincoln Navigator, vehicle number two, which had significant damage to the front of the vehicle. Standing next to vehicle two was a man who stated to this officer that he was the operator of vehicle number two. He stated his name was Dale Trump, and he was 42 years old. The first individual who was extracted from vehicle number one was an 18-year-old female, one Sophie Davis. This officer attempted to interview her concerning the events relating to the accident, but was unable to do so because of her hysterical state. She was screaming, crying, and attempting to get to the vehicle and was forcibly restrained by an EMT. I was able to learn that she was in the front passenger seat when the accident had occurred. In talking to her, this officer detected a strong odor of alcoholic beverage emanating from her. It was also noted that her speech was somewhat slurred. Another individual removed from Vehicle 1 was sitting on a gurney provided by an EMT. I was informed by the EMT that he appeared to have a broken leg and a broken collarbone. I spoke briefly with this individual, who stated that he had no recollection of what had happened at the accident. He identified himself as Kelly Garner, age 18. According to an EMT who extricated Garner from the vehicle, he was occupying the left rear seat of vehicle number 1 at the time of the collision. While this officer was there, another individual was removed from vehicle number 1. He was later identified to be Ben Chase, age 18, who was apparently seated in the right rear passenger seat at the time of the collision. He was unconscious, and I was informed by the EMTs that he was being flown to the General Hospital as soon as possible. Lying next to the car was the operator of vehicle number 1, Jake Matthews. He appeared to be severely injured and was in a semi-conscious state at the time. I attempted to speak with him, but he was just mumbling, "I can't feel my legs. I can't feel my legs." This officer detected a very strong odor of alcoholic beverage emanating from Matthews. This officer then interviewed Dale Trump, the operator of vehicle number 2. He was standing by his vehicle at the time of the interview. While talking to Mr. Trump, I noted a moderate smell of alcohol beverage. He said that he had spent the evening with his girlfriend, Darla Royer, at 738 South Burnside. He admitted that he had 2 glasses of wine, but denied having any more than that. I asked him if he would submit to a field sobriety test. He said he would. I then performed the HGN test, a horizontal gaze test, and I had him perform the one leg test and the heel to toe field sobriety test. Mr. Trump completed these field sobriety tests without significant difficulty. I asked him to describe how the accident occurred. He said he was going northbound on Burnside, approaching the intersection with 8th, and as he put it, the car was just there. He said it was his recollection that the light was green when he entered the intersection for operators going north on Burnside. I asked him if he took any evasive action to avoid the collision. He shrugged and said, I think the light was green. It just happened so fast. They were just there, you know. They were just there. I asked him what speed he was traveling, and he said, truthfully, I was probably going about 50 to 55 miles an hour. I noticed that there were no skid marks or any other indication that Vehicle 2 had braked before the collision. Photographs were taken of the scene by Officer Thad Wankel. These photographs have been developed and are in evidence in a room at the police station. There was also a news crew from Channel 5, Eyewitness News, who came on the scene soon after. While walking around the scene, I discovered there was a small handheld video recorder on the pavement. It was still operating at the time I picked it up. I turned it off and turned it over to our photograph laboratory to see what film was on it. The following day, I was informed that the recorder had actually recorded the accident And it is clear from the video recording that operator number one, Jake, the operator of the vehicle number one, Jake Matthews, was distracted from observing the road ahead, and he failed to detect a red light at the intersection of 8th and Burnside. I was also able to determine from later interviews that he was traveling at an excessive speed, probably 50 to 55 miles an hour. The speed limit for both 8th and Burnside at or near the intersection in question is 30 miles per hour. On June 13th, I interviewed Sophie Davis at her home in the presence of her parents. She informed this officer that she was the girlfriend of Jake Matthews. June 6th, the day before the accident, was graduation day for her and the other occupants of the vehicle. The four individuals in the vehicle spent the evening before the accident at a friend's house with a number of other members of the graduating class. The classmate whose house were having the parties was David Sickles, the son of Robert and Brenda Sickles. She admitted that everyone at the party was drinking both beer and shots of vodka. She said they were playing beer pong at the party. She said they had left the party a little after 1 a.m. the following morning. I asked her if they were drunk when they left the party. She nodded yes and said very drunk. I asked her if Jake Matthews was drunk. She replied, very. I asked her why he would be permitted to drive the vehicle. She shrugged and said, he seemed like he was the least drunk of all of us. It was his car. Besides, he always drove. I asked her whether Ben Chase was drunk, and she replied, very drunk. Oh, yeah. I asked her what speed she thought vehicle number one was traveling at the time of the accident. She said, I guess about 50, 55 miles an hour. I asked her if Mr. and Mrs. Sickles were at the residence during the party. She said she couldn't remember them being there. I asked her if she thought Mr. and Mrs. Sickles knew that there was alcohol being served to minors at their home. She said, I think so. I asked who purchased the alcohol for the party. She said, I don't know. It was just there. On June 13th, I interviewed Kelly Garner. He was at his parents' home and in the presence of his mother at the time of the interview. He had a cast on his right leg and was in a sling. He informed me that he had a broken collarbone. I asked him what happened in the accident. He said, I can't really say. I don't really remember much about it. I asked him if he was at the party. He nodded that he was. I asked him if he had anything to drink. He nodded affirmatively. I asked him how much he had to drink. He said, a lot. We were playing beer pong. He said he probably had 4 or 5 beers and several shots. He said, I'm not going to kid you. I was really messed up. I think we all were, to be honest with you. On June 16th, 2005, I attempted to interview Jake Matthews, who was in intensive care at the General Hospital. Present with Mr. Matthews was his attorney, Jake Gittes. Attorney Jake Gittes indicated that he didn't think it would be a good idea for Mr. Matthews to be interviewed, both because of his physical and his mental condition. And as Mr. Gittes put it, you know, I just don't think it would be a good idea. Mr. Gittes informed me that Mr. Matthews had a severe head injury as a result of the accident. More significant was a severe spinal injury, which severed his spine in the lumbar region of his back. Mr. Gittes informed me that Mr. Matthews is paralyzed from his waist down. And according to his physicians, it is extremely unlikely that he will ever be able to use his lower limbs again. On June 21st, 2005, search warrants were obtained from the Honorable Daniel Burke. The search warrants are attached to this report, and they sought an autopsy from Ben Chase, who died several hours after the accident, as well as the laboratory records from General Hospital with regard to the blood alcohol level of the three other occupants of the vehicle. The search warrant was served the following day, and the records requested were obtained. The autopsy report of Ben Chase indicated that he died from blunt force injuries and contusions to the brain. He was unconscious at the time of the accident and never regained consciousness. Blood alcohol results indicated that his blood alcohol level was 0.28, over three times the legal driving limit. Hospital records indicate the blood alcohol level for the driver of Vehicle 1, Jake Matthews, was 0.27. The blood alcohol level for Kelly Garner was 0.24, and the blood alcohol level for Sophie Davis was 0.27. The hospital records indicated that Kelly Garner suffered a compound fracture of the tibia and a broken collarbone. Sophie Davis was diagnosed with two broken ribs and a number of lacerations. Ben Chase suffered severe brain contusions and contusions of the brain, as well as concussion, a fractured spine, and the severance of his spinal cord.
Corporal Alden, is there a video recording of the scene of the accident?
Yes, there is.
Was this video recording found at the scene of the accident?
Yes, it was.
And on this video recording, does it depict the actual accident?
It does.
Your Honor, may we play this video for the jury?
You may.
Thank you.
Does Commonwealth have any other questions of this witness?
It does not, Your Honor, and the Commonwealth rests.
You may step down, ma'am. Mr. Lindsay, is there any defense witnesses?
No, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you have now heard all of the evidence which is to be presented in this case, and the next step is for the attorneys to give you their closing arguments. Even though those arguments do not constitute evidence, you should consider them very carefully. In their arguments, the attorneys may call to your attention the evidence which they consider to be material and important, and they may ask you to draw certain inferences from that evidence. Please keep in mind that you are not bound by their recollection of the evidence. It is your recollection of the evidence and your recollection of your recollection alone, which must guide you in your deliberations. If there is a discrepancy between the attorney's recollection and your recollection, you are bound by your own recollection. Furthermore, you are not limited in your consideration of the evidence to that which is mentioned by the attorneys. In fact, you must consider all of the evidence which you consider important to the issues involved in this case. To the extent that the inferences that the attorneys ask you to draw are supported by the other evidence and appeal to your reason and judgment, you may consider them in your deliberations. The attorneys may also call your attention to certain principles of law in their argument. Please remember that you are not bound by the attorney's statements as to the law, only the statements as the court gives it to you pertaining to the law are you bound by. And you must apply the law as the court gives it to you to the facts as you find them to be. Now, under the Pennsylvania Rules of Criminal Procedure, the attorney for the defendant makes the closing argument first, followed by the closing argument of the assistant district attorney. After they've concluded their arguments, then the court will give you the final instructions on what the law is in this case. Until then, you will not be able to make your decision without having the benefit of all of that information. So with that, Mr. Lindsay, you may make your closing argument.
May it please the court.
Mr. Lindsay.
Madam Prosecutor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, good morning. I have a difficult job to do this morning. You just witnessed a very unusual piece of evidence, a piece of evidence that we don't normally see, and it graphically portrays an incredibly sad situation. It stirs our emotions. I have a difficult job because I have to appeal to your intellect, because this is the most intellectual game that we have these days, where jurors must take evidence, not emotions, but evidence, and apply them to certain crimes. Each crime has an element, or elements, specific things that you must find exist. Your job is to take the evidence that you heard in this trial from the corporal, and also what you saw in that film, and take the elements that the judge gives you for each specific crime for which my client, Jake Matthews, is charged. And you must put them together. And that's what your job is. If there's a dispute in the facts, then you must resolve that dispute. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I really don't think there is much dispute about the facts. This is an unusual case because the facts are about as clear can be. But application of these facts to the elements of one particular crime is not so clear. The word that comes to mind when I think about this case is linkage, linking. And it concerns one specific crime that the court will tell you about later when he gives you the charge. There are three crimes with which my client is charged. The first is what we call DUI, or driving under the influence. The judge will instruct you what the elements of the crime are. In this particular case, the elements include the fact that my client was driving a car, and while he was driving the car, he, among other things, had a blood alcohol content in excess of 0.02 or 0.08 if he was an adult. He's not at the time of the accident. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the hospital records indicate, and we cannot and do not dispute, that the fact that his blood alcohol was not 0.02, which was 0.27. I would believe that if you did not find my client guilty of that particular charge, you would not be doing your duty. The second crime with which you will hear about is homicide by vehicle. And the judge will instruct you as to the specific elements of this particular crime. But homicide by vehicle would indicate that my client was driving a vehicle, that there was a death caused, and the death was the result of his reckless driving, careless driving, extreme indifference to the value of human life. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I once again must concede this particular charge. Because you see, as we know, my client was operating a vehicle at 50 miles per hour, 50, 55 miles per hour, in a zone of 30 miles per hour. He did not see a red light. He did not see a red light because he did not look at where he was going. No matter how I cut this, no matter how thinly I'd like to slice this, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, that is reckless behavior. And once again, I must concede that if you do your duty, you would find my client guilty of that particular offense. But it is the third offense with which my client is charged that I would like to discuss the rest of my allotted time about. The crime is called homicide by vehicle while under the influence of alcohol. Now, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, please do not be misled by the title. This particular crime, you cannot convict him of this crime simply because he was in a vehicle, there was a death, and he was driving under the influence. There must be linkage. And what do I mean by linkage? I believe the judge will tell you that with this particular crime, you must show you must find beyond a reasonable doubt that my client was operating a vehicle, that there was a death. Number three, that he was under the influence of alcohol, and there is this one element. You must find beyond a reasonable doubt that the DUI, the influence of alcohol, caused the death. In other words, by a reason, what caused this accident? Can you find beyond a reasonable doubt that it was the driving under the influence? Our position is the evidence would not support that verdict. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, there has been no evidence that's been submitted by the Commonwealth in this case that would make that linkage. Do you recall an expert witness telling you that clearly, that based on all of the facts in this case, the alcohol, the driving under the influence, caused him to put himself in a position, him and his passengers? Do you recall that testimony from an expert witness? I don't recall that testimony. There was none. Were there other legitimate reasons for this accident to occur other than driving under the influence? Well, of course, we know what caused this accident. We know what caused this accident. He wasn't looking where he was driving. He was in his vehicle in this animated state, looking over to his left at the passenger who was filming him and making statements to her. He was looking away from the road. He ran a red light. That's what caused the accident. There's no evidence that that was related to alcohol. Now, I have to concede something to you. And maybe you've never had this experience because you're a better driver than I am. Sometimes I think I'm the worst driver in America. But there are times, I'm getting pretty old, but there are times when I've been on the road when I have looked away from what I should be doing, picked something off the seat, talked to someone, and suddenly found myself veered into another lane, ran a red light. I've done this so many times. And I after I do this, I think to myself, oh my God, thank God. Why was I so fortunate that I could do this? Was I under the influence? No. Was I drinking at all? No. And maybe you people are good drivers and you've never had that experience where you were distracted for some reason that you looked away from the road. Unfortunately for Mr. Matthews and his passenger Ben and his passenger Sophie and Kelly, he was not so fortunate. And certainly they were not so fortunate. My point is this, you can look away from the road, you can have an accident, you can be extremely negligent and have nothing to do with the consumption of alcoholic beverages. There was also the other operator. It was an interesting testimony. He testified, as I recall, that the car was just there. He didn't brake. He didn't notice the car. He just, bang, hit the car. Was that a factor in the accident? Yes. Am I suggesting that this gentleman caused the accident? Well, he was the cause? No, I'm not suggesting that. I'm just suggesting it's another factor that weighed into this particular incident. What about everyone else? What about the parents, Mr. and Mrs. Sickles, who apparently, as far as we know, supplied alcohol for these young people? What did they have to do with the causation when we put it all together? All I'm suggesting to you, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, is that there was no evidence submitted by the Commonwealth that would show beyond a reasonable doubt that the alcohol caused the accident. Of course, you might say, and it might be argued by the Commonwealth, well, it's common sense. When you're driving under the influence, you do things like this. Common sense tells us these things. My old advocate, common sense. before you buy into the common sense argument, it's all just common sense, I would like to address that. When we talk about common sense, I think there's nothing really common about it. It is rarely sensical. I believe it was Albert Einstein that said that common sense is a collection of all the prejudices we accumulate by the time we're age 18. Common sense is often the argument that jurors and prosecutors use when they can't put the evidence together with the elements of the crime. If you choose to rely on your common sense to find my client guilty, please remember this. It was once common sense to believe that the earth was flat. It was common sense that the sun revolved around the earth. It was common sense that slavery was an appropriate way to treat people in the South. It was common sense to separate the races from each other. Common sense is often not at all sensical. I like to say that in a jury trial, common sense is often that comfortable couch that jurors choose to lay on when they want to kick their brain into neutral. Please don't fall into that trap. When we look at events that happen on days like June 6th, we want people to take responsibility. That is the idea that we want everybody to take responsibility for everything that they've done. Take responsibility. I'm interested in word origins, where they come from. We use certain words, and it's often useful to look back at where they come from. And when I was thinking about this case, a word kept coming into my mind, and its origin kept coming into my mind. It's biblical at its origin. Leviticus chapter 16. Look it up. Check it out. It's in the book. They had a practice that they did, the children of Israel, every year. Once a year they had a day. It was called the Day of Atonement. And the Day of Atonement, every man would come forward and confess the sins that they had committed for the last year. Aaron, the chief priest, would take two goats, and he would bring the goats up and they would cast lots. One goat they would sacrifice, a sin sacrifice, as a result of their sins. Each man would come forward and confess his sins. And Aaron would take these sins and place them on the head of the other goat. They would take this goat then and lead it out into the desert and let it wander away. The name of the goat, they called the goat the scapegoat. And that's where we got that expression, the scapegoat. This young man, who it's my privilege to represent, has taken responsibility. There are others who are responsible, who are not here today. Mr. and Mrs. Sickles are not here today. The other people at the party are not here today. Kelly is not here. Sophie's not here. They are not here. It all falls on the head of this young man. Now, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the prosecutor in this case, I've conceded that my client is appropriately charged with crimes, significant crimes indeed, and I'm sure you will find him guilty of those crimes. But that's not enough. The prosecution wants more. I've always thought when I was a prosecutor, now that I'm a defense attorney, that when we talk about proof beyond a reasonable doubt, what does that mean? And I think what it ultimately means is this, is your decision should be very easy for you. That everything falls into place. This is the evidence. Here are the elements. This is easy. But sometimes as a prosecutor, they like to stretch, go that extra mile, to make things difficult for you, to stretch on an element. In this particular case, we're saying they are stretching on that particular element. There is no evidence that would support, beyond a reasonable doubt, a finding that the alcohol caused this particular accident and death. The prosecution, once more. I would only tell you this. My client is a prisoner. He will be imprisoned in that chair for the rest of his life. He will suffer to that extent. And then there are the dreams. The dreams that he has. In his dreams, he walks. In his dreams, he runs. In his dreams, he's back there on that warm, sunny day, June 6th. He's there with Sophie. He's there with Kelly. And he's there with Ben. And when he wakes up, he must confront the horrible reality of how that lovely, lovely day turned so terrible. That's all.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Ms. Lauterbaugh, you may give your closing argument now.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court, Mr. Lindsay.
Ms. Lauterbaugh.
Whoops. Ladies and gentlemen, the jury, June 7th, 2005. That's the day that Ben Chase died. You saw it on the tape. He was a recent high school graduate, 18 years old. He had his whole life ahead of him. Whether he wanted to go to college, get a job immediately, he had his whole life to decide what he wanted to do. But on that day, Ben Chase died. And he died as a result of severe brain injuries that he incurred as a result of a DUI accident that was caused by that defendant, Mr. Jake Matthews. Now, you sat through the trial. You heard the evidence presented. There was a party. It was a celebration celebrating graduation. It was at the Sickle residence, and everyone was having a good time. They were drinking beer, taking shots, playing beer pong. Everyone there was drinking. You heard that Ms. Sophia Davis was drinking. Mr. Ben Chase was drinking, the deceased. And of course, the defendant, Jake Matthews, he was drinking as well. You heard from the video, they were all intoxicated, very intoxicated, too intoxicated to drive. But it was at that time the friends decided they're going to leave the party. They had enough drinking, enough partying, it was time to go home. But then the defendant, Jake Matthews, decided he made the decision in his intoxicated state to get behind that wheel of his SUV and to drive his three friends. And in making that decision, not only did he put his own life at risk, he put the life of his three passengers at risk, and he also put the lives of other drivers on the road at risk. The life of Mr. Trump, whom he crashed into, and you saw it on the video. The friends, you saw how they were acting in their intoxicated state, laughing, joking around, not paying attention. The defendant himself, he wasn't paying attention to the road. We know what alcohol does to the body. It impairs your judgment. It impairs your senses. It impairs your reaction time. It impairs your motor vehicle skills, your ability to control a motor vehicle and observe what's happening around you. And it's essential to have these skills when you're driving a motor vehicle. It's very dangerous not to be able to know what is going on around you while you're operating such a dangerous object. And ladies and gentlemen, you saw in the video, that is exactly what happened. The defendant, Jake Matthews, in his intoxicated state, with his senses impaired, his abilities impaired, he didn't notice the red light. He ran right through that red light, and then He slammed right into Mr. Trump's vehicle. And unfortunately for Mr. Ben Chase, he was severely injured in that accident. And he never recovered from these injuries. And so, ladies and gentlemen, you heard from the defense attorney. The defendant is charged with DUI, driving under the influence. And you heard from Corporal Ogden that the lab report showed that the defendant was driving with a 0.27 blood alcohol content. Now, for an adult, the legal limit is a 0.08. Had the defendant been an adult, he would have been driving three times the legal limit. Three times the legal limit for someone over the age of 21. But he's only 18 years old. The legal limit for him was a 0.02. Now, I'm not fantastic at math, I'll admit that, but he was a 0.27 with a legal limit of a 0.02. I believe that's almost 12 times the legal limit for an 18-year-old was in that defendant's system when he made the decision to get behind the wheel and drive his three friends on that roadway. Defense counsel also points out that the defendant is charged with homicide by vehicle. And again, defense counsel concedes that if you do your job as you were sworn to do, that you should find the defendant guilty of that charge. And of course, as a prosecutor, I agree with that decision. You saw in the video, and there was sufficient testimony from the trooper, that yes, indeed, the defendant was traveling in excessive speeds. He was doing a 50, 55 miles per hour in a 35 mile per hour zone, so he was speeding. And then, of course, as we also saw in the video, unfortunately for him, he did run the red light, which again is a traffic violation. And as we all know, the ultimate result was the death of Mr. Ben Chase. But now let's turn our attention to the homicide by vehicle while DUI. Now, there are several elements that the Commonwealth has to prove beyond a reasonable doubt for you to find the defendant guilty of homicide by vehicle while DUI. And of course, the first element that you have to find is that, in fact, the defendant was DUI, or driving under the influence. But I think we all agree, and even defense counsel agrees, that the defendant was DUI. He was driving under the influence. And again, he was doing this by being three times the legal limit had he been over 21. But since he was only 18, it was almost 12 times the legal limit. So clearly the defendant was DUI. Now the next element we have to look at is, did somebody die? And of course, it is undisputed that Mr. Ben Chase did die as a result of this accident. So that's not even seriously disputed. But then the next element that we have to look at is that the defendant negligently caused Mr. Ben Chase's death. And that does get a little more tricky, but let's look into it further. Basically, if we reflect on what Corporal Ogden had testified to, as well as if we remember what we saw in the video, they were all partying. They were all drinking. The defendant himself was partying. He was drinking. He was very intoxicated. And then he decided, again, knowing the effects that the intoxication of alcohol was having on his body, he made the decision to be the driver with his senses impaired, with his cognitive abilities impaired, with his reaction time and judgment impaired, and also with his fine motor skills impaired. Knowing all of this, he still decided that he was going to drive. And again, you saw how he was acting on the video. I think that's proof enough of how intoxicated the defendant was. And in his intoxicated state, he wasn't paying attention. Of course he wasn't paying attention, because that's what alcohol does to your body. When you decide to consume that much alcohol at a party, your inhibitions are out, your judgment's out, and your ability to drive is out the window. And so that alone, I believe, is enough to show that the defendant was negligent in causing the death of Ben Chase, but it goes further. Not only was he driving while DUI, he also ran the red light. And again, why did he run the red light? He ran the red light because he was not paying attention. And so why was he not paying attention? Did he drop something? No, he didn't drop something. He wasn't paying attention because his ability to perceive the situation was thrown off. And the reason why it was thrown off was due to his intoxicated state. So there is a linkage. There is a linkage between the DUI and the running of the red light. And what is that linkage? The linkage is if you take into account the effects alcohol has on your body, it causes you to not pay attention. It causes you to not pay attention to what's going on the road, where you should be focusing. And that's what happened in this case. He wasn't focusing on the road where he should have been focusing on due to his intoxicated state. And so, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I submit to you that the Commonwealth has met its burden on the charge of homicide by vehicle while DUI. And essentially, I would ask you to find the defendant guilty of that charge and all the other charges as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lauterbach. Members of the jury, it is now my obligation to give you the final instructions concerning your duties in this matter and the law. You must dispel from your hearts and minds any passion, prejudice, sympathy, or bias, or any other preconceived idea you may have. You are here as officers of the court charged with the responsibility of participating in the administration of justice here in Mercer County, Pennsylvania. Your most important function is to determine the facts. That determination must be made solely from the evidence which was produced in this case while you were seated together in those chairs in the courtroom in the presence of the court, the defendant, and the attorneys. You and you alone must determine what actually happened, if you can. You will take the law from the court as being the best evidence of what the law in this case is, and then you will apply that law to the facts as you find them to exist from the evidence which has been produced. A fundamental principle of our system of criminal justice is that the defendant, Jake Matthews, is presumed to be innocent. The mere fact that he was arrested and he's accused of crimes is not any evidence against him. Furthermore, the defendant is presumed innocent throughout this trial, and unless and until all of you conclude, based on careful and impartial consideration of the evidence, that the Commonwealth has met its burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, and on every element of the offense, only then can you remove the cloak of presumption of innocence from the defendant. It is not the defendant's burden to prove that he is not guilty. Instead, it is the government that always has the burden of proving each and every element of the crimes charged, and that the defendant is guilty of that crime or crimes beyond a reasonable doubt. As you probably know, a person accused of a crime is not required to present evidence or to testify in their own defense. In this case, Jake Matthews chose not to testify or put on any other witnesses. You may not hold that against him because that's his right. You may not infer any guilt from the fact that he exercised his right to remain silent and not to present any evidence affirmatively. If the Commonwealth has met its burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, it is your duty, despite how you may feel, to find the defendant guilty. On the other hand, if they have not met their burden of proof, you must find the defendant not guilty. Even though the Commonwealth has the burden of proving that the defendant is guilty, this does not mean that the Commonwealth must prove its case beyond all doubt or to a mathematical certainty, nor must it demonstrate the complete innocence of the defendant. A reasonable doubt is a doubt that would restrain a reasonable, careful person who is sensible from acting upon a matter of importance in his or her own personal affairs. I'll repeat that. A reasonable doubt is a doubt that would restrain a reasonably careful and prudent person from acting upon a matter of importance in his or her own personal affairs. A reasonable doubt must fairly arise out of the evidence that was presented or out of the lack of evidence with respect to some element of the crime. A reasonable doubt must be a real doubt. It may not be an imagined one, nor may it be a doubt manufactured to avoid carrying out what might be viewed as an unpleasant duty. So to summarize, you may not find the defendant guilty based on mere suspicion of guilt. And the government has the burden of proving the defendant guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. And if it meets that burden, then the defendant is no longer presumed to be innocent, and you should find him guilty. On the other hand, if the government does not meet its burden, then you must find him not guilty. Mr. Lindsay indicated to you that it was unusual that we had a video of what occurred. I can tell you that in my 12 years on the bench and the 19 years in criminal defense work, I don't think I've ever seen a video of what the government says occurred. So there's an impact that a video has upon you. And the impact can be an emotional one. And it was told to you that this is not an exercise of the heart or of the emotions. This is an exercise of the mind. So you cannot base your decision on sympathy, either for Mr. Matthews because of his condition. You cannot base it on any dreams. You must base it on the facts and the law as you find the facts to be in this case. It is also not your job to send a message for this kind of conduct. Although certainly there is a message that needs to be sent, but that should not be reflected in your verdict. Your verdict must be based on evidence and the law. So let's now focus in on what he's charged with and whether the government has met its burden of proof. First of all, the defendant has been charged with violating the DUI laws of Pennsylvania. And there are two ways, as I told you earlier, for them to prove it. The first is what's considered the general impairment provision, where they have to prove that an individual was incapable of safe driving. So to find Jake Matthews guilty of this offense, and even though his attorney concedes that the evidence is there, it's up to you to find him guilty based on what you believe the evidence to be. The government would have to prove to you beyond a reasonable doubt the following two elements. First, that Jake Matthews was driving a motor vehicle on a highway. Second, that he drank so much alcohol that he was incapable of safe driving. Under Pennsylvania law, the phrase incapable of safe driving has a precise legal meaning. The defendant need not have been drunk or severely intoxicated or driving wildly or erratically to commit this crime. It is enough if alcohol had substantially impaired the defendant's normal mental or physical faculties that were essential to safe operation of a vehicle. Thus, when deciding whether the Commonwealth has met its burden of proof on DUI, you must ask yourselves, were the defendant's thinking, judgment, physical skills, ability to perceive and react to changes in situations as he drove, or other faculties impaired? If so, how badly? And was the impairment caused by his use of alcohol? You also may consider the defendant's blood alcohol level, along with all the other evidence relevant to his condition, when you decide whether or not the defendant was incapable of safe driving. The second way they can prove the DUI has to do with the blood alcohol content level, which has nothing to do with whether or not he was incapable of safe driving with that alcohol in his system. So under this situation, the government must prove beyond a reasonable doubt the following three elements. First, that the defendant was under 21. Second, that the defendant drove a vehicle on a road. And third, that he drank a sufficient amount of alcohol such that his alcohol concentration in his blood was 0.02% or higher within 2 hours after driving. The Commonwealth does not have to prove under this particular section of the DUI statute that the defendant was incapable of safe driving. The government only has to prove that the defendant's blood alcohol level was in the prohibited range within this two-hour period after driving. Also keep in mind, you may be able to find the defendant guilty of the first section, the incapable of safe driving section that I defined just a minute ago, regardless of whether or not you can determine his blood alcohol level. The defendant's blood alcohol level is not an element of the general impairment charge that I previously outlined. It is only a piece of evidence relevant to the question of whether he was under the influence of that alcohol. There are two homicide charges here. Let's first talk about the homicide by vehicle, which is a general homicide by vehicle charge under the vehicle code. There's something I want to tell you here, and normally we don't in criminal cases, and that is, if he were found guilty of homicide by vehicle, he could receive up to 7 years in jail. In this case, the government would have to prove the following elements beyond a reasonable doubt. First, that the defendant ran a red light and/or was speeding. The allegation is he was traveling 50 miles per hour in a 30 mile per hour zone. Second, that the defendant acted recklessly or with gross negligence, such as by speeding and/or running a red light. Third, that Ben Chase is dead. And fourth, that the defendant's vehicle code violations, the running the red light and/or speeding, were the direct cause of the death of Ben Chase. The word recklessly, for purposes of homicide by vehicle, requires that the defendant engaged in conduct like speeding and/or running a red light, and that he consciously disregarded a substantial and unjustifiable risk that his conduct would cause death. The nature and degree of the risk being such that it is grossly unreasonable for him to disregard it. Grossly negligent is another phrase, and that's defined for purposes of homicide by vehicle, requiring that the defendant drove in a manner that he should be aware that he created a substantial and unjustifiable risk that his grossly negligent conduct, if you so find, would cause death. The nature and degree of the risk being that it is grossly unreasonable for him to fail to recognize this risk. In deciding whether the defendant's driving was reckless or grossly negligent, you should consider all of the evidence, all of the relevant facts and circumstances proven to you, including the nature and extent of the defendant's driving and his conduct, and the circumstances known to him at the time. If you are satisfied that the government has proven each of these elements of homicide by vehicle beyond a reasonable doubt, then it is your duty, despite the penalty, to find him guilty of that offense. If you find that he has not been proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, then you must return a verdict of not guilty on that charge. The final charge, ladies and gentlemen, is the one that seems to be at the greatest dispute here, and that is homicide by vehicle while driving under the influence of alcohol. It's probably in dispute because the penalty is different. It's more severe. There is a mandatory 3-year minimum term of imprisonment that Jake Matthews would have to serve if he's found guilty of this offense. But that's not for you to consider. But that's why it's really being contested in this case, I would suggest to you. So in order for the government to prove homicide by vehicle by DUI, you must find that the government has proven each of the following additional elements beyond a reasonable doubt. First, that Ben Chase is dead. Second, that Jake Matthews unintentionally but negligently caused his death. A person acts negligently under criminal law, and there's a distinction between civil law, which is simple negligence, much lower standard, and criminal law, which is gross negligence. A person acts negligently in criminal law when he should know of a substantial and unjustifiable risk that his conduct will cause at least serious bodily injury. The risk must be of such a nature and degree that the defendant's failure to perceive it, considering the nature and intent of his conduct and the circumstances known to him at the time, involves a gross deviation from the standard of care that a reasonable person would observe in the defendant's situation. And the last part is probably the most important, so I'll repeat that. Involves a gross deviation from the standard of care that a reasonable person would observe in the defendant's situation. And the third element, which was argued to you as not being proven by Mr. Lindsay, is that the defendant caused the death of Ben Chase as a result of the DUI, the alcohol consumption. In order to be a direct cause of the death, a person's conduct must be a direct and substantial factor in bringing it about. There can be more than one direct cause of the death. It's been argued to you that parents may have provided alcohol, other people may have provided alcohol, there might have been other things going on in the car, and that those people maybe were part of the cause, or that the other driver perhaps may be somewhat at fault. Well, the law says that a defendant who is a direct cause of an accident may be criminally liable even though there are other direct causes. For example, in this case, you might find other potential causes of the accident, such as Jake being distracted by his drunk friends in his car, or the other driver being negligent, Mr. Trump, maybe being at fault to some degree for failing to avoid the accident or going too fast himself. Nonetheless, Jake Matthews can still be guilty of this crime if you find under all the circumstances that his conduct was a substantial factor in bringing about Ben's death, even though other factors may have contributed to the cause of the accident. Jake Matthews is not a direct cause of the death if you find that the actions of a third person or persons and or the occurrence of another event plays such an independent, important, and overriding role in bringing it about compared with the role of the defendant that the defendant's conduct does not amount to a direct and substantial factor in bringing about the death. A defendant's conduct may be a direct cause of the death even though his or her conduct was not the last or immediate cause of it. A defendant's conduct may be a direct cause of the death if it initiates an unbroken chain of events leading to the death of the victim. If you find that the government has proven each and every element of the offense of homicide by DUI, then you must find the defendant guilty, despite whether or not you feel sympathetic towards him because of his condition from this accident. Otherwise, you must find the defendant not guilty if they have not established that. In a few minutes, you will be taken to the jury room to begin deliberations in this case. The first thing that you need to do is elect a foreperson. Elect somebody that you believe will undertake to organize the deliberations of the jury. That person would also supervise or fill out the verdict slip that the court has prepared for you. And that person would also act as the spokesperson when you come into court to announce the verdict of the court to the court. After you've elected a foreperson, you should then review the testimony and evidence which has been produced in this case. Review the evidence from each witness who testified and determine to what extent you should accept that testimony or evidence. Having done that, then apply the law to the facts as you find them, which will bring you to the critical question, and that is whether or not the government has proven each and every element of the offenses charged beyond a reasonable doubt. Whatever your verdict, It must be unanimous. We cannot accept a verdict which does not represent the unanimous agreement of all of you. This means that in order to return a verdict, each of you must agree to it. You have a duty to consult each other and to deliberate with a view to reaching agreement, if it can be done without doing any violence to your individual judgment. Each of you must decide the case for yourself, but only after there has been impartial consideration with your fellow jurors. In the course of your deliberations, each juror should not hesitate to re-examine his or her own views and change his or her opinion if convinced it is erroneous. However, no juror should surrender an honest conviction as to the weight or effect of the evidence solely because of the opinion of other jurors or for the mere purpose of returning a verdict and going home. And after you have agreed upon a verdict, it will then be your duty to fill out the verdict slip and then announce the verdict in open court. Your decision in this case is a matter of considerable importance. Remember that it is your responsibility as jurors to perform your duties and reach a verdict based on the evidence as it was presented during the trial. However, in deciding the facts, you may properly apply common sense and draw upon your everyday practical knowledge of life, as each of you has experienced it. You must keep your deliberations free of any bias or prejudice. Both the Commonwealth and the defendant have a right to expect you to consider the evidence conscientiously and to apply the law as I have outlined it for you. In arriving at your verdict, you should not concern yourselves with any possible future consequences of that verdict on the defendant, particularly pertaining to any penalty. The question of guilt and the question of penalty are separate issues, and the question of penalty is not for you. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have prepared a verdict slip for you that you will take with you in the verdict in the jury room. It basically lists the charges in pretty much an order of DUI, the two subsections. The foreperson should simply check guilty or not guilty under each one of these if they have a unanimous verdict. You'll note that on number three, which is homicide by vehicle by DUI, if you were to find him not guilty of both DUIs, you would not even go to the homicide by DUI question. You would skip it. Otherwise, it's your duty to go to each and every question on this verdict slip, answer it, knock on the door when you're finished, and the court crier will bring you back into the court for the verdict to be announced. At this time, I'll ask the court crier to come forward to be sworn. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the searcher of all hearts that you will take charge of this jury and that you will not suffer anyone to speak to them, nor speak to them yourself regarding this case without leave of court, unless it is asked to ask them whether they have agreed upon a verdict? And that is you shall answer to God on that last great day.
I do.
Ladies and gentlemen, you may now go into the jury room, and we'll be in recess until the return of the verdict.
John, approach that recess. All rise. This honorable court is now in session. Please be seated.
Would the foreperson please stand? Madam foreperson, has the jury reached a verdict?
We have not, Your Honor.
Have you reached a verdict on any of the charges?
We have.
How many charges have you not reached a verdict?
Two.
Would you please hand the verdict slip to the for the court crier? And the jury is deadlocked on the other two charges?
We are.
You have a verdict on three out of the four charges. The third charge is the homicide by vehicle while DUI. That's the one that you are deadlocked on, right?
Yes.
So we'll declare a mistrial on that offense. The verdict slip is otherwise in order. So on the charges that you have reached a verdict, I want you to read this, please, out loud.
Yes, sir.
In the Court of Common Pleas of Mercer County, Pennsylvania, criminal, Commonwealth of Pennsylvania v. Jake Matthews, our verdict, and now on this 24th day of April 2015, we, the jurors impaneled in the above-captioned matter, find as follows. On the charge of driving under the influence of alcohol to the degree that the defendant was unable to drive safely, we, the defendant, Jake Matthews, and we, the jury, find you guilty. On the charge of driving with blood alcohol level in excess of the legal limit for a minor of 0.02% or greater, we, the jury, find you, Jake Matthews, guilty. On the charge of homicide by vehicle, we find the defendant, you, Jake Matthews, guilty.
Please hand that to the court crier. You may be seated. We'll direct that the verdict slip be recorded as it's in proper form. And we will sentence Mr. Matthews at the end of May. We'll be sending notices to them in the mail. Ladies and gentlemen, this has obviously been a very difficult case. It's a difficult issue in general in society. And the court appreciates your attention to the details and your service in this matter. You are discharged, and we are in recess.